Welcome to the Flame and Fiber Podcast, episode number 23. It's February 26th, 2017. My name is Barbara. You can find me on Instagram and Ravelry as Diva. There's a Flame and Fiber Podcast Ravelry group where we're running a couple of cals now. I would love for you to join. And I want to say welcome. Thank you so much for checking out my podcast. If you're new, I hope you enjoy it. And if you're coming back, I really, really appreciate that. And thank you so much for all the lovely messages and comments from the episode last week. I was feeling weird last week, and you know, so, but I'm feeling much better. I wasn't at all anxious today. I don't know what happened last week. It was a weird week. But anyway, I'm drinking some decaf tea, Blackcurrant Beauty by Pukka. I don't think I've ever had this before. I was just grabbing something without any caffeine. Oh, I like that. Good. I'm glad because I'm going to be drinking it. Because I keep talking and I need to have something to drink. But anyway, welcome. This is a podcast about lamp working. And I'm still trying to decide if you've seen... I don't think you've seen any lamp working yet, but... I did do a recording of me doing some lamp working this week, and I'm guessing that I'm gonna put it at the end of this episode. I was thinking about making it a separate little, you know, part two episode. I have this idea that it's better for my podcasts to be under an hour, and I'm not sure why I have that idea, and I don't know what better means. Because surely you can stop watching it at any minute, and you know, so I'm probably going to put it, that recording, at the end of this episode, which is why it's so long. So if you're not interested in lamp working, you can, you know, it won't be an hour and 20 minutes or whatever it is when you're looking at this. But if you're interested in lamp working, I did some this week. But also, this is a knitting podcast and sometimes a spinning podcast, but I haven't spun. I seem to be getting ready to spin, but I haven't actually spun yet. But you'll be able to see exactly what lamp working is at the little recording at the end. But in that recording, I am making some what are called head pins. And in that recording, I tell you that I will show you the head pins that I'm making, because once they're hot and they go straight into the kiln, it's hard to see the colors. And I ended up making quite a few, and I, you know, didn't record the whole session. So I'm not sure exactly which ones I was making, but these are head pins, and I was making leaves. And I'm not sure exactly which ones I was making on the video, but this is the kind of bluish green one. This is a red one. This is the one, I'm sure I was making this one. This is the one with the silver glass. And I was trying to remember the name of the silver glass company. It's Double Helix. I'm sure I'll put that when I edit too. But so these are leaves, and I will make a little loop here and then put them on a jump ring, and they will be beautiful stitch markers. But I was also making flowers. I have a little flower press mold, and you'll see that in the video. And I was making this style of flower in the video, where when they're stitch markers, they're going to be kind of facing down. And you know, I wasn't sure exactly how that would work or how it would be. Well, it turns out that I made some adjustments in how I was holding the mold. And so later ones, which you did not see me make, ended up with the flowers facing one direction. So this is what the stitch markers are going to look like. And so the little flowers will be hanging. And I got some, it's hard to see, but I got some shine on some of these. These green ones are actually silver glass. And I got some very shiny ones that I was really tickled with. And I think you can see the sheen on this. So that turned out to be a pretty flower. So that'll make a nice stitch marker. So I'm the process of working on stitch markers for part of the prize packages in the knit along. So if you want stitch markers, I hope you like little flowers and I hope you win. So anyway, that's what I was making in that video. And you'll see, I hope it turned out. I actually haven't watched the video. Oh, I haven't watched the video. It may be terrible. Well, I'll put it in whether it's terrible or not. If I think it's terrible, I'll put that very big, this is terrible, don't watch it if you don't want to watch it. Because I should have thought of that before. I know you've had an edit right there because I had to go get a tissue and blow my nose. I'm probably going to try to edit this a little more aggressively than I usually do, and I will be very interested to know what you think about that. I find it somewhat disconcerting when I watch a podcast and it's heavily edited and the video jumps. I mean, usually the voice continues. I mean, they're basically cutting out pauses and things, but I watch. So I find it a little disconcerting, but it also means you don't have to sit there while people collect their thoughts. So I may be doing some, you know, more aggressive editing on this podcast just to see how I like it and what you think about it. So I'll be very interested in your comments on this. The other reason for that is I did not write down a single note for this podcast, so I could be rambling like crazy. So I'm going to be cutting things out. Like my tea drinking. So anyway, so you saw my lamp working, and those hadn't been cleaned in any way. I'll take steel wool, fine steel wool, and clean the wires before I turn them into stitch markers. And I will try to do that this week and show you those stitch markers next week. So that will be fun. So I said I wasn't feeling anxious this week, but I was sitting there thinking that it would be nice to have a finished object because I didn't have one last week. And I have been wanting to do a little more with my tiny things, so that seemed like the perfect combination. So I have two tiny things. These are little elves. And this is the Christmas Cork Elves and Pals. Sorry for the beat up thing. I sat on it and ripped it, by Irish Magda. And it's a free pattern on Ravelry, Christmas Cork Elves and Pals. And so these have a champagne cork. Dennis has been saving the champagne corks and the kava corks every time we have kava, which we do pretty regularly. So he's got, and I've been having him save them for a while. So I've got a nice little pile of corks, and I thought these turned out so cute. I can't believe I forgot to bring up the bag these were in. So I can't tell you what the yarn is. I'll put it down there. Most of the yarns are an acrylic, and it's a very light fingering acrylic, and so I held it double because the pattern is for a DK, and I held it double and I think it turned out just right. And they're all this acrylic. I got it at Joann's, except for this hat. This was one of the wonderful Valentine, Gnome Acres Valentine minis that Linda gave me. Thank you so much, Linda. And look how adorable he is. I'm telling you, I was like, wait a minute, why am I using this stuff when I have wonderful things I can make the hat out of? So I did. So I'm really tickled with these tiny things. I hope you're making tiny things. We have the Knit Tiny Things knit along going on, and people are making tiny things. And thank you so much for participating. There's a thread in the Ravelry group. And oh, I will be taking pictures of these and entering them in the Naughty Knitwits Stuff It Cal. And I need to check out Molly from Homespun House because she's got an ornament knit along going on. And I think these might qualify, but I'm not sure. But I know they qualify for the Stuff It. So anyway, so these are my finished objects, my tiny things. They turned out so cute. I'm so tickled with them. And I got plenty more corks where they came from. Oh, and there's another pattern by the same person, Irish Magda, And it's Cork Angels. So I might be doing some angels to go along with my gnomes and elves and whatever else those are. So those are two things I'm going to be working on. These, I don't know why. I thought I had a mushroom pattern, but I couldn't find it. There's a mushroom pattern that goes on a regular cork, and I guess I don't know why it wouldn't work as well or better on a champagne cork, but maybe I'm crazy. I thought I had a mushroom pattern. I was looking for a mushroom pattern to go with my champagne corks, but these are adorable. This guy. I love this guy. Thank you, Linda. I love this hat. This was my first one, and I learned a lot. This hat, I think, is too small. I like the bigger hat. I just added a little bit, and I still need to work on the proportion of the sweater to the face, to the head. I'm not going to be putting faces. I think they look cute just like that with their little scarves. So those are cute. So that's what I did today. I didn't get very much knitting done at all yesterday because we had company for dinner, and it's important for me to have company periodically because otherwise my house never gets clean. I mean, I swish a toilet pretty regularly. Other than that, I really don't do very much. And I don't vacuum nearly as often as I should, and I have a German Shepherd that sheds like crazy. So I was and Dennis was cooking, so I'm the cleaner. And so I spent all day yesterday cleaning the house, getting ready for the company. We had a wonderful time. Dennis made a delicious meal, and we had a lovely, lovely evening. So I didn't get much knitting done on Saturday. This is Sunday that I'm recording this. But so I worked on mainly two things this week. I have been working like a dog on Dennis's sweater. I am so tickled with how it's going. When last we met, I had started, oh my gosh, I'm in the middle of a sleeve. I can't believe it. Huh. I must have had to get up and feed the dog or something and then forgot what I was doing. But anyway, I'm gonna get my thing over there. What a mess. This part will get cut out and then you won't see me struggling. So this is where I was last week. So I had done the cuff and not even a whole stripe because this stripe wasn't, I had done about this amount of a whole stripe because this is a short stripe. And then now I'm all the way to here on both of my sleeves. And this green stripe that I'm on now is the last stripe before it joins the underarm. So the underarm, and you know, where the front of the sweater started after the underarm started with a beige, and so the next beige will be that same stripe. So I am pretty close to I'm feeling like I'm seeing the finish line here. So this is the Kierouac sweater by Jen Jarvis. So this is the row that I'm doing now. So, and this is where this is the row I'm doing now because I'm on the sleeve of the sweater. And then this stripe is where it meets the underarm. And then, so this is how much of the sleeve I have left to do. The two sleeves. Then I have to put it together and I have to do the button band. And the button band is sewn on. It's not, you don't pick it up. You just knit this really long thing and then you sew it on around the sweater. So I promised Dennis he was going to have this sweater when we go on our trip at the end of March. And I told you last week that I intended to try to make it so that it would have qualified for the Buy the Book Cal, which is our second Cal that's going on in our group, which ends on March 15th. And that's still my plan. I plan to have that sweater done by March 15th. So the other main thing that I have been working on is my snow melt shawl, which is the Mystery Knit Along by Helen Stewart, the Curious Handmaid. So I have finished, I guess it was Clue 4. Yep. So I have finished Clue 4. I was in the middle of Clue 3 in my last podcast, but I finished Clue 3 and I finished Clue 4. So each clue is about 20% of the knitting. And Helen has this wonderful way of keeping track of how many rows you're on and how many stitches and what percentage you've done. And so the end of Clue 4 ends at 79%. So we only have one more clue left, which we will get on Thursday. So if you don't want to hear about this or see the Mystery Knit Along, then move ahead, because I'm going to be showing it. All right, so here it is. Clue 4 was pretty straightforward, except at the very end of Clue 3, we once again doubled the number of stitches, because this is a half circle shawl. So we doubled the number of stitches to 521. And you looking at the wrong side? Because I was looking at the right side. So I think I was about here, maybe last week. I'm not sure. I didn't move my progress keeper, so I'm not exactly sure. And now, because we're so long, it's hard to show you this without worrying about losing stitches. But so this is Clue 4. It was actually not very many rows, because the rows are so long. It was only about from 179 to 196. So it wasn't that many rows, but each of the rows was pretty long. So right now we were using colors B and C. And at the end of Clue 4, she said to break off color C. So that makes me think that we are going to go into colors A and B for the next clue. The other thing is that she added 2 stitches. So we're ending with 523 stitches. And because of the nature of these rows, it didn't feel super important to keep super hard track, because the lace, while there are some yarn overs, the lace is very simple. And I did have a problem. I dropped some stitches and I didn't have a lifeline, which I am very sorry about, let me tell you. And I had a little trouble, and you can see I had a little trouble picking them up and getting the stitches right. This is right here. So I don't think it matters in the grand scheme of the shawl. I hope that it doesn't ruin it, because if it does, I'm going to be very unhappy. Because I didn't go back and fix it, because, well, it is what it is. I'm pretty sure it just is what it is. And in the big shawl, I think it'll be okay. And if it isn't, then I may try to do some repair to it afterwards. You know, just like weaving in some whatever. I don't know. I don't know what I would do. But I didn't fix it, and I'm not going to fix it now. So, I mean, I tried to fix it when I was there, and I tried to figure out the stitches, and boy, I couldn't do it, as you can see. It looks worse on TV than it does in person. Of course, it's one small part of a giant thing, so I'm hoping it doesn't matter. But anyway, in the process of that, I think I got the right number of stitches back on the needle, but I'm not positive. So what I have to do before Thursday is make sure that I have the exact right stitch count, because I am positive that there's going to be a lot of lace. She does like a lace border on her shawls. So I think the border of this is going to be lacy. And she added 2 stitches. You have 521 stitches. You don't make it 523 unless you need 523 stitches. So before Thursday, when the next clue comes out, I am going to make sure I have 523 stitches. Because that is going to be important. That's going to be more important than my bad patch job, which... it would have been so much work to go back and fix that. But now, of course, I feel like I should have done that. But I didn't. Anyway, maybe I just edited that out. That pause. So this yarn is yarn that I dyed. It's single in, it's a merino single that I dyed. And this is color number 1 and 2. So these are the 2 colors that are going to be in the next, A and B, rather. The light one is A, and the darker one is B. And they are going to be the colors of in the next clue. So she did, one of the things she did tell us was that color A is going to be lace. So I think, I'm expecting a little more of a lace coming up in the next clue. So, so I'm looking forward to that. I hope I'm not too sad about that boo-boo because I didn't fix it and I'm going to try to go fix it after the fact. If I, you know, if it blocks and it looks too terrible. The only other thing I worked on, and I worked on it very little, which you haven't seen lately, are my, my cup of tea socks. And that's where I was the last time you saw it. So I've only done a little bit. These were my second February socks. So these are going to end up being my No Man's Land socks. But these are for me. So they will go in the box of socks knit along. Box of socks cal that Kristen of Olenvine is running. Because these are for me. But they're not going to be finished in the next 2 days. So they won't be eligible for any of the other cals that I'm in. But I will start a new pair of socks, whether these are finished or not. I'll start a new pair of socks on the 1st. And I'm looking for a slip stitch pattern because this is the yarn I'm going to be using. This is the yarn I got from my sock club. From the ladies at Toad Hollow NJ, the Crafty Toads. And that's going to be my March socks. And because of the way the colors are, I want a slip stitch pattern. So I'm looking for a slip stitch pattern for that. So my area is such a mess because I don't have any good excuse for that. So that is what I am working on. I didn't do anything on my scrappy blanket and I didn't do anything on my fade. I got really into knitting on Dennis's sweater and I thought, you know, strike while the iron's hot. If I'm wanting to knit the sweater, I better just sit and knit it because that's really the most important thing I'm knitting because I really want him to have it for the vacation. And that sweater has been on my needles for over a year, I'm sure. Or a year. I have to look at my project page, but it's been a very long time. And I'm tired of them hanging over my, that sweater hanging over my head. And, oh, I didn't even show you the yarn. Ugh, podcaster fail. So the yarn I'm using is the Outlaw, I'm back to Dennis's sweater. This is the Outlaw yarn, which is a wonderful yarn, Bohemian Sport. It's 45% Polworth, 45% alpaca, and 10% possum. And I am really enjoying knitting with this yarn. So I'm loving the knitting. I'm perfectly happy to have a knit where I just can sit there and do stockinette. And the only thing, I mean, I had to do increases, you know, so I'm keeping track of my increases. Where's my edge? Keeping track of my increases with my, holy cow, I can't show you anything. It's so rolled up with my stitch markers and counting my, how many. But because I'm doing the sweater, the sleeves two at a time, it's not so crucial that, you know, it says every 8 rows I'm supposed to do an increase or every 12 rows or whatever. You know, and if it's 13, it doesn't matter because they're both going to be exactly the same. As long as I end up with the right number. And I have, you know, sort of tried the sleeve on Dennis and it seems to fit him. So everything seems to be fitting him. So I'm real tickled about that. So anyway, that's the yarn. I'm using a Chagu needle. And I don't know what size this is. I think it's probably a 4, but I will put it on the screen because I have to look it up. I have to test my thing because I can't read the etching on the needle. I'm using, my bag is getting too small for this shawl. My cord is getting too small for this shawl. I think this is a 5. This is a 6. So this is also Chagu. This is my Chagu interchangeables. So yeah. So this is a 6. So I think Dennis's sweater is on a 4 because this is a 6. But I'm using the Chagu interchangeable for this. So that's nice. And when I was making these, this is going to be the least coherent podcast ever. These were made on a size 3 needle. And I used my Hiya Sharp interchangeables for these. And this one was the first one I did, and I did it as the pattern stated. I did add two more rows of face because it didn't seem to, when I tried it on, it didn't work. So I added 2 more rows. I actually cut his face off and did a new face because it didn't work. But I knit this one in the body flat, and then I seamed it, which was how the pattern was written. And then I thought, so I knit the hat in the round. But the hat was, I thought, a little too small. But because even after it was seamed, I could get this knitted part off and on the cork, then it didn't seem to me like it made any sense to knit it flat. So I knit this one entirely in the round. And I made the hat bigger, and I like the way this hat fits better. So, and these were done on size 3, Magic Loop. Hiya Sharp interchangeables. And, oh, I think that's the knitting. I think that's the knitting for the week. I've done a lot of knitting, and I'm getting very excited. I can't believe I was in the middle of a row. I'm getting very excited about Dennis's sweater. And I'm, in part, because it looks like it's going to fit him. He tried on the body last week, and I tried on all the different parts of the arms to make sure that they, you know, was going to be long enough, that the cuff was going to be loose enough, that because he's going to generally push his sleeves up like that, because that's how he wears things. And so I wanted to make sure he could do that, make sure there was enough room. He has very broad shoulders, so I'm not sure if I have to do anything to make this sweater comfortable for him across the shoulders. I mean, I can't make the back any wider because that's already done. But I could make the sleeve wider at the top, which might, I don't know. I guess I should think about that because I'm getting right to that place. But anyway, I really enjoyed the knitting of that this week. And so the only other thing, I have some goodies. I told you last week that I had some goodies on the way, and they both came. And I watch the Lone Larch podcast with Jenny. I hope you watch that podcast. She is a lovely, lovely woman. She lives in Olds, Alberta, Canada, which is the same town as Laura the Fawn Knits. So I don't know how big of a town it is. There's a university there, I know. But she is an arborist, and she doesn't have very much work in the winter. So she's knitting and she's making lots of project bags. And in the summer, she, you know, works on trees and things, and she still makes project bags. But anyway, I really like her podcast, and so I was watching it the other week, and she was having a pre-order for some bags. And I loved the bag, I loved the fabric, and so I pre-ordered the bag. I have another one of her bags, which I really love. She does beautiful work. I don't know if you can see how glittery this is, but this is a metallic. It's a little bit of a metallic, but look at these beautiful trees. And this is a beautiful bag. She puts a leather tie here with her Lone Larch thing and a handle. And I really like this handle. I mean, this is a handle you can really use. And I like the inside. This is also glittery, which you're also not seeing how glittery it is, but it's like the branches of the trees on the outside are being blown away on the inside, which I really like. And she, like I said, does beautiful work. And she uses that quilting interfacing, so these are nice and squishy. And she sent me a sample. I think her sister-in-law or a good friend or something sells this lip balm, Unite, Demo, Love Yourself Lip Balm. But anyway, that was in the bag with a nice little note. It was very sweet. So I got this, and I don't need any more bags. I know I don't, but I loved it, and I love her podcast, and I wanted to support her. And she has a section on her podcast called For the Love of Trees. And, you know, when she's working, it's often, you know, she'll record herself, you know, trimming a tree or climbing a tree, and we get to see her chainsaw and all this cool stuff. But in the wintertime, she's not doing very much with actually working on trees. And she's reading a book, and I'll put the name of the book down here because I forgot to look it up before I started podcasting. The Secret Life of Trees or something like that. And so in her For the Love of Trees sections of her podcast, she's been reading from this book. Now, I like trees, you know, well enough. Dennis and his mother are very interested in trees. They'll often wander off and look at the trees or whatever, you know, and I let them go have a mother-son moment because I'm not that interested in trees. I mean, I like trees. Don't get me wrong. But, you know, so she started reading from this book, and I'm thinking, you know, do I really care about trees? Maybe I'll fast forward, but I didn't. And I'm so glad I didn't. She's read several pieces from this book, and it is actually really fascinating. And I never thought I would be fascinated by hearing all about trees and how they grow and things like that. But this guy's a very good writer. And it's really interesting. So I'm really glad I didn't fast forward. In fact, I'm thinking about getting my mother-in-law this book because she's interested in trees. And maybe reading it myself because it's really, really interesting. So anyway, Jenny is a lovely, lovely woman, and she has a really, really nice podcast, and she's a great knitter, lots of knitting. And she makes a beautiful bag. So these are my goodies, and I highly recommend her podcast, the Lone Larch podcast. And she's Lone Larch Designs on Instagram and Gentastic on Ravelry. So that's one podcast I can recommend, and that's one of my goodies. And another podcast that I was watching last week, I guess it was the week before last because I knew this was coming when I podcast last, that I watched was The Periscoping Sisters. Now, they're two sisters, Debbie Reese and Amy Meeks, and I'm sure you are all familiar with them. If you're finding my podcast, you've probably already found theirs. But if you haven't, I highly recommend it. They're two really interesting women, and they do designing together and each separately, and they're a lot of fun. And their Aunt Jan is a sewist, and Debbie is putting Aunt Jan's bags in her shop. Oh, my nose is itchy again. Last week, my nose was so itchy. And I was watching their podcast, and this bag showed up on that podcast, and I was like, I gotta have that bag. I don't know what it was. This bag just grabbed me. I love that orange sun. The fabric is like, it's got like, I don't know, wrinkles in it, you know, I mean, it's supposed to, it's not, you know, I don't, it's not a bad sew job, let me tell you, because it's beautifully made. Now, this one does not have any interfacing at all, so it's a nice soft bag, which I don't mind either. I like them, I like actually anyway, so it doesn't matter, really matter to me, but I don't know whether this will stand up by itself or not, but it has this beautiful batik fabric on the inside, but it's light. I do like a light inside of my bags because it makes it a lot easier to see your stuff at the bottom. But this is a nice big bag and it's got a box bottom. So this is going to hold a lot of stuff. So I bought Aunt Jan's bag. I just thought it was a beautiful bag. And I don't know why. Sometimes oranges and reds just grab me. And I was like, oh, I want that bag. But The Periscoping Sisters is another podcast that I highly recommend. They're in different places. So that podcast is one of those split screen podcasts where, you know, like Sue and Chelsea on Legacy Knits. But when they first started, and actually they're having their anniversary very soon, so they've been doing it for a year. When they first started, the video quality and sound quality was not very good in their early podcasts. And I stopped watching it because it drove me crazy. But they have worked really hard and improved it, and it's terrific. They you know, so the quality is great and they're funny. Amy Meeks is a hoot. She's a real sassy kind of, but funny. But I'll tell you, I met her at Indie Untangled on the Friday night before Rhinebeck and introduced myself. And she was as lovely and happy to talk to me. And she didn't know me from Adam. And you know, I had made her Because I Love You shawl for my mother for Mother's Day. And, you know, and she was just as charming and lovely as you can imagine. Debbie was there too, but she was standing in line at the Wollenbein booth at the Moment Show. So Amy was by herself. I did meet them later at Rhinebeck and got to meet Debbie as well. But they were lovely. And so I highly recommend their podcast if you haven't seen it. They're, you know, they got the sister dynamic going, but they're very funny. And they're designers, so they're very interested in design, and they're doing a lot of knitting and doing some interesting stuff, so that's fun. So I recommend their podcast as well. Since I'm buying from them and I'm buying from Jenny, I love the Lone Larch podcast. She's wonderful. So those are two podcasts that I can recommend. I love the Mean Girls. Where are you, girls? I'm waiting for the next episode. Rebecca and Stephanie, they are a wonderful sister team and interesting, and they are Stephen West fiends. So I'm sure the next episode is going to be all about the new Stephen West mystery knit along, which I am not going to be doing. 10 different yarns. You're supposed to come up with 10 different yarns. No way. I've stopped. I'm not even working on my fade. I'm still on yarn number 3 of my fade. I can't. I just can't. The timing isn't good for me anyway. I'm going on vacation in a month. And I got to finish Dennis's sweater. And I had some hopes of making a sweater for myself out of that beautiful silk that I bought at Vogue Knitting Live. And I haven't given up hope for that because it would be a t-shirt. And it would be you know, possibly doable. Maybe I'll be knitting it on the plane. I don't know. But I'm not going to be doing any Stephen West mystery knit along. Although I will be very, very, very interested to see what's going on. But I am sure that the Mean Girls are going to be doing that mystery knit along. They did the building blocks, and theirs were beautiful. And in fact, it was looking at their building blocks when they were done that made me think I should have done the building blocks. But his timing is bad for me. I mean, his last mystery knit along was in the fall when I'm in the middle of my Christmas knitting, and now I'm going on vacation. I got another. I'm not sure. I mean, I bought what West Knits Best Knits, and I like most of the things in that book, but not everything. I mean, there are a couple of his shawls that I don't want to have and I don't want to knit. And I mean, if somebody gave it to me, I would be gracious. Oh, my nose. But, I hope. But I'm never going to knit, ever knit some of those. That eyeball shawl that he designed, that's not for me. I don't get it. I don't get the eyeball shawl. So I won't be making that. And, the doodler, I'm not going to make the doodler. But there are a lot of other ones. But anyway, so Helen Stewart, I trust with my mystery knit along. And I guess I'm just not ready to take the leap with Stephen West yet. And maybe it's just because I'm a chicken. Because I'm sorry. I was sorry that I didn't do the building blocks, even though I couldn't possibly have done it because of the timing. But I liked the shawl at the end. And so I did chicken out after what. I mean, I bought that one. And I chickened out after watching the video about the first clue. So anyway, but the Mean Girls, another podcast that I highly recommend. And I hope they have another, well, they're going to, because I'm sure they're going to tell us all about what's he calling it? Oh, I forget. The Stephen West Mystery Knit Along. I'm not remembering what he was calling that. So anyway, I am going to, let me talk a minute about our knit alongs. We have the By the Book Knit Along that we're doing with the Moms with Yarn podcast. Sharon and I are doing this, co-hosting this together. And so check out her podcast. And if you are knitting anything that you owned the pattern before 2017, it qualifies because WIPs are allowed. And so if you finish it by March 15th, you'll be eligible for prizes. There's a finished objects thread in the Ravelry group and a chatter thread, and beautiful, beautiful things. And there aren't a ton of them in there. I think there are 25 or 30. So, you know, the chances for a prize are good. Plus there's going to be a prize for the chatter thread and a prize for the finished objects thread. So come and participate and you could win a prize. And we also have the Knit Tiny Things knit along. So this is a year-long knit along, and it's basically knit tiny things, little things like this, little ornaments, little stuffies, little tiny things. And my idea is that I want to be ready for Christmas next year. I want to do an advent for my granddaughter, so I need to have a lot of little things to put in her advent. And I want to have ornaments and things ready for Christmas next year and not be having to make something every day. So in December, so that I have what I need. So I'm starting early, and if you want to join me, please do. I'm going to be drawing a prize from that thread, and it's a chatter and finished objects thread altogether. And I will be drawing for a prize approximately once a quarter. And so I will be drawing prizes. You're just going to have to give me your information really quick after I announce the winner, because I'm going on vacation, so I'll only have a week between the time I announce the winner and the time I leave. So if you don't get in touch with me right away, then you'll have to wait till I come back. But anyway, so, and these tiny things, as I said, qualify in the Naughty Knitwits Stuff It Knit Along. So mine are going in there so I can participate in that and encourage myself to knit tiny things. So that's about it. I would love to, see you, introducing yourself in our welcome thread. I would love to know more about you and join the group. It's a lovely group of people, really sweet people, and that are making beautiful things. So come and check out the Ravelry group and subscribe and like and, you know, all those things with the YouTube channel so that you hear about the next video. And I'm going to say goodbye, but I'm going to be putting my lamp working session at the end of this, so it's coming right now. So I will say goodbye, and I hope you have lots of time over the next week before I podcast again to get in a lot of knitting and crafting that brings you joy. And I hope you enjoy my lamp working session. And I hope I enjoy it when I look at it and see. Hope it's worthy. If it's not, I'll just put it here. Forget it. It was crap, and I'll do another one. Oh dear. I'm sure it'll be fine. Anyway, have a good week. Bye. I'm actually recording this on Friday, February 24th. I think it's February 24th, and I haven't been in my studio for quite a while. This is my lamp working studio, so we're getting a little flame in the Flame and Fiber podcast here. And I am going to be making some stitch markers. And I'm making them on, I don't know if you can see there, maybe you can see, this is a copper wire. And I have it on a giant roach clip. Oh, they're probably not called that. That's probably not their official name. That's like a giant roach clip. So that I can use this. Typically, beads are made on mandrels, which are metal rods with a bead release on the end so that you're able to actually get the bead off. I have some beads that I made at another session quite a while ago now soaking so I can get the bead off, but you can see that the bead. Wow, that's a strange one. Oh, I was making a mask. And because this is a ceramic wash, kiln wash kind of, it will come off. Eventually come off the mandrel. But I'm going to put these straight onto copper wire, and then I will make a loop in the copper wire and turn it into a stitch marker. And I hope this works. I do not have a, you can see my face. I'm wearing dark glasses. Hello. These are Dididium glasses. They will protect my eyes from the sodium flare. I am going to do a little warm up using just making a leaf. I made a lot of leaf stitch markers for Rhinebeck. And they were really cute, and they were pretty straightforward to make. Well, I'll make one. Well, not my first one. I'll do a warm up bead in orange. So it'll be like it's a fall leaf. So I start by warming up the glass a little bit slowly, so I put it at the end of the flame, which you're probably not seeing very well. I'm going to turn this a little bit, and you don't need to see so much of my Iowa, and maybe see a little more this way. My daughter did her graduate work at Iowa. Hello, Iowa! And so I have an Iowa t-shirt. And today is February 24th, and it's about 75 degrees. Outside. I live in southeastern Pennsylvania. So it's a crazy day, which is why I you know, take advantage of the weather and get out in the studio, because the studio isn't heated, even though I spend a lot of time in front of a flame. And I have a kiln going that's going to go up to 925 degrees. The glass will not stick unless it's on, except onto something warm. So I have to heat up the wire as well. And this is just a quick, I'm going to make a quick leaf. They may all end up being leaves because I haven't figured out what I really want to make on the end of these wires. I have should have been thinking about it, and I haven't been. The leaves turned out really well, and I was happy with them, and maybe leaves will become my trademark. I have a tweezers that have a little bit of a leaf motif. Not really, but it's a petal tweezers that make it nice and flat. Now the glass did not stick. Oh, maybe you couldn't see that. I'm sorry. I'll do it again. The glass doesn't stick to these tweezers because the tweezers are cold. If they were hot, or if I use them too many times, they will stick. So I dip them in water if I'm afraid they're getting too hot. And I'll do the same thing with my, these are regular tweezers that I will be making the leaf motif with. Just play with the glass. It's nice and soft when it's hot, and when I tell you it's hot, I am not kidding. So you might think that getting cut when you're a glass worker is the problem, but obviously now when you're looking at my setup, you can see that the problem is perms. So you have to be careful. Okay, so there's a leaf. This one will be orange. The orange goes very dark when it's heated up. It will lighten up as it cools. I'm using tweezers to get it out of the roach clip. And this is my kiln. It's hot enough, I think. I just turned it on. It's up to 840 degrees. So the kiln is used to anneal the finished pieces. They will sit, this kiln is going up to 925. They'll sit at 925 for the whole time that I'm working here. And then they will, I will launch it to its annealing routine. And the way that works is it will stay at 925 for a half an hour, and then it will slowly lower the temperature to, I don't even know, I'm not sure exactly what the sequence is, but it's like 8, maybe 875, and it'll sit there for an hour or two, and then it'll go to 800. Anyway, it steps down and it holds at each of the temperatures, and it goes down very slowly, and I will come out here. So I will launch, probably end up launching the kiln at about probably 4:30 or 5 this afternoon. It's 3 o'clock in the afternoon now. And it will be an 8-hour cycle. So I'll come back. I will come back tonight before I go to bed to turn the kiln off. And at that point, it will just be naturally dropping its temperature just based on atmosphere, you know, the temperature here. It'll just slowly be coming down to room temperature. And when I come out at 11, it'll probably be around 200 degrees at that point, is my guess. I sometimes open it when it's that, but it's not good. I should wait, and so I'll come out in the morning, and it'll be all cooled down, and I'll be able to see how my leaves turned out. I'll have a good idea how they are. I do have some reactive glasses that, you know, you can't really tell what they're going to look like until you see them after they're cooled. So I'm just making some little leaves on the end of these wires, and then I will use my jewelry making tools to turn them into stitch markers. And I will be using these. We have two knit alongs going on, so I will be making stitch markers for some of the prizes. And I am planning to go to Maryland Sheep and Wool, and I think they have in the past had a podcasters meetup. I've never been to it, but previously, but I plan to go this year. And so I want to have some swag to. All right, this is a fancy glass. This is a silver. This glass has silver in it. You have to be careful. I have it. You can't see it, but you can probably hear it. In fact, you may not be able to hear me. But I have a very, very heavy-duty ventilation system right over this torch. And this is, torch is, I have it hooked to a propane tank, just like you use on your barbecue. And my ventilation system is right here, and it is there to draw out the fumes. And the glass that is the most fumy and the most dangerous fumes are the silver glasses. But, oh, they turn out so beautiful. So I am making, this glass is called Gaia. It's a silver glass from, something striking. I'll look it up and put it on the screen. I have not bought glass in a long time. You think I have a stash of yarn? OMG. I have so much glass. I won't say a ton because it's not literally, I don't think. I'm pretty sure it's not a ton. A literal ton. Oopsie. Now, I'm talking and my wire is not hot enough. And so it wasn't sticking. I was trying to put the glass on the end of the wire and it wasn't sticking. So anyway, I can't remember the name of the company that makes this beautiful, beautiful silver glass. They have all kinds of beautiful silver glass. So this color is green in the rod, but it turns into all different colors when you process it. So I will be doing some stuff to this. And I'll tell you the truth, I haven't used this glass in a while, so I may, you know, who knows? It could turn out looking like mud. You know, it's a little bit like, I guess, like dyeing. Sometimes it works, and sometimes it doesn't. If it doesn't, it's mostly because I'm out of practice, not because of the glass. So I'm going to make it into its leaf shape. And then I'm going to strike it and reduce it. I think this particular one is actually a reduction glass. And that means reduced oxygen. So if we have a reduction flame is a flame that's high in propane and low in oxygen. Right now, this is called a dual fuel torch that I'm using. And I have propane and I also have an oxygen source. So I have a medical oxygen concentrator underneath this desk and it's pumping oxygen into this. So I have this is where the gas comes in and then I have a thing for oxygen and you'll see the way the flame changes because I'm going to turn down the oxygen and now the flame gets all bushy and like that. That is because it has way less oxygen than it had before and it's completely changing. Oops, there's hardly any oxygen. And this is a reduction glass. So I don't think you're going to be able to see the changes in that, but it's starting to get an interesting film on it. And it's going to be a little bit like an oil slick on this leaf. And I will be careful to remember exactly which leaf I did this with so that I will show you when the podcast resumes with me up in my office. And I will show you this exact leaf. So what I'm doing, I don't know, I don't know if you can tell, I also want to make sure it doesn't get cold and crack because the glass has to heat, stay warm or it will crack. You don't want to crack this glass because this is not cheap glass. That would be like messing around with cashmere. This is the cashmere of lamp working glass. It's very pricey and it's very amazing. Oh, I'm getting some color in here now. I can't even tell exactly how it's looking. Oh, it's looking very gold, sort of shiny gold with some purple touches. Because of my didium glasses, I can't always tell what the color is. So I don't know if you can see the changes in that glass. It was pretty just green. It was green before, but now it's really shiny. But I'm not gonna mess with it too much because I have a tendency to overdo it. And I don't want to, because I think that's gonna be a beautiful stitch marker. Beautiful. All right. So this is my lamp working studio, and this is me making stitch markers. And I think you've already seen me making these leaves before. So I am going to try something. I have a mold that's supposed to make a flower. I have never gotten it to work correctly. I'm gonna fix my flame. So now it's got oxygen back in it. I have never gotten one to work. So there's no reason to think this is gonna work, but I thought I'd give it a try. And you know, some things work and some things don't, but ugh, and my kiln is buzzing. Oh my gosh, that's gonna drive me crazy. And you too, I'm sure. Oh well. The kiln has a, you saw me, I just flicked the switch to turn it off and turn it back on to try to get rid of that sound. That's the reason that I have to come and shut off the kiln at night, because it has that manual on-off switch. And so as it's running through its anneal cycle, it is on. And even when it's done annealing and it's just taking the temperature and everything is now room temperature, it's still on. And we have actually pretty surprisingly unreliable power at this house. Our power goes out regularly enough that we have a generator and we have it hooked into our system because we have a well. And if the power goes out while the kiln is in its annealing cycle, because it's flipped on, when it comes back on, it'll come back on to 925 degrees, which is not what I want. So as a precaution, I make sure that I turn it off before I go to bed in case we lose power in the middle of the night. I don't want it re-ramping up to 925 and ruining my... Oh, that didn't work too terrible. There's a little flower. Huh. Well, what do you know? Should I wreck this little flower by giving it some stamen? Let me try that. See if I can. That'll probably pop out anyway. Yeah. Not loving it. Let me get them out there. Problem. One of the hard things about doing a stitch marker or doing this is actually called a head pin. Because you can make these and then, you know, put beads on them and turn them into earrings and things. They're very handy to have, and you can have beautiful head pins. Oh, I'm really tickled with that little flower. I'm keeping it. I think I need to get better colors for that. Because the wire is thin and you can't put a lot of pressure, sideways pressure or anything on what you're working on to change its shape because you have the wire woman. So there's only so many different things that you can do with on a head pin easily. So if you see anything really complicated on a head pin, kudos to that artist because it is not easy. But I don't have a lot of experience on head pins. I've just started doing them since I've been knitting and podcasting, actually, because I don't think I did any. I did some head pins when I used to. Let me start over. I used to be a very prolific lamp worker. When I first retired, I had been lamp working for a while, and I continued lamp working, and I sold my beads. There are Facebook groups. Just like there are Facebook groups where you can sell your yarn. If you're a yarn dyer, there are Facebook groups where you can sell your beads if you're a bead maker. And I was doing that. And I probably told you the story the last time I was in the studio, but Dennis kind of laughed at me because he said I was working harder selling my beads than I had been before I retired when I was working at my job. Oh, turning out cute. Hey, I'm pretty happy with that. Because those were an auction style. You will have, you know, your beads up for 24 hours. Whoever, at the end of 24 hours, whoever offered you the most money won, and then you contacted them and they paid you and blah, blah, blah. But it was an incredible amount of work. It wasn't like Etsy where you could, you know, have a, where you have a site that sort of takes care of that. Somebody paid and, you know, whatever. I mean, you didn't have to pay a fee, and that was nice, but oh my gosh, it was kind of exhausting, and I burned myself out. I did it for a whole fall, you know, I mean, for quite a while, that money was paying for my yarn. It also paid for my glass, which is why I have so much glass, but I started knitting, and I had burned myself out on the lamp working, so I wasn't doing much of lamp working. So by the time I started knitting, I was not making head pins or anything like that. So I did sell head pins on my site. And my leaves were quite, I made bigger leaves than these because in jewelry, usually you want something bigger than this. But for head, the other thing with stitch markers is you want small things because you don't want a big honking stitch marker. I'm so tickled with these little flowers. Oh, nobody's going to be impressed with my flowers when they see it only takes 5 minutes to make a flower, and I use a mold. But you know what? How do you like that? Well, that's good. So I have some options because I do like the leaves. But it's nice to have. But how about a little bouquet? My guest bathroom, I have these with a bouquet of glass flowers. I was making glass flowers for a while. Nice big ones, about yay big. Oh, you know what? I'm going to run out. I'll cut this part out because I'm just going to leave. I run outside because I put some flowers. There's a window in, well, I'll tell you the story when I'll show. This little shed has two small window boxes underneath the little windows, but those windows, I don't know if you can see those very well, those windows are in the shade. They face the north, they don't get any sun. So I went to my flower place and say, I want flowers, but I want them to hang down because I don't want them to cover the window, I need the light. And he laughed and said, you're not getting any flowers. So I made flowers. So I just took these out of my window box. They've been in there for 2 years. They're turning out pretty good. Pretty happy with them. And I have a bouquet of those in my guest bathroom, in my powder room. And and that's fun. I wonder if I can make a flower out of the Gaia and see how that would look. I'm pretty tickled with these flowers, but anyway, I have a lot of glass, and I went through, you know, the knit from your stash. Well, I had a make beads from your stash year, and I told you this last time too, I'm pretty sure, but, and I did pretty well. I did not buy any glass until November that year. So, and I was making a lot of beads. I have so much glass. I do not know. When I finally decide I'm not a lamp worker anymore, I do not know what I'm going to do with all this stuff. I guess I'll find somebody who wants to be a lamp worker and make them a deal. But I'm not ready to say I'm not a lamp worker. That's for sure. I think I'm a little bit of a pyromaniac too. So let me see what I can do with this and see if I can make a nice flower out of the Gaia. How fun would that be? What I can do with this Gaia. Let's see what kind of flower this is. I'll show you this one too. Maybe I'll get some of the other glass. Oh, I wish I could remember the name of that company. They make beautiful stuff. They have all kinds of stuff. They have their own version of Stellina. Oh, I should make something out of that so you can see it. Alright, I'm using my wrong hand here. Will all be downward pointing because of the way the mold is set up. I guess that's okay. Alright. So, this is me making some stitch markers. I'll show you these first ones that you watched me make. I will show them to you in the podcast. And I hope you found this somewhat interesting.